ओके 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 ठीक है. सो हु विल स्टार्टिंग?
हेलो एंड नमस्ते. वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल प्रेजेंट हियर. आई निशित पटेल ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ IITC PDPU स्टूडेंट चैप्टर वुड लाइक टू वेलकम आवर एस्टीम्ड गेस्ट डिग्निटरीज एंड ऑल द स्टूडेंट्स जॉइनिंग अस फ्रॉम डिफरेंट यूनिवर्सिटीज. टुडे इट्स एन एब्सोल्यूट प्रिविलेज टू हैव विद अस मिस्टर माइक ड्यूबोस, वाइस प्रेसिडेंट IITC, मिस्टर लार्स जॉर्गेंसन, रीजनल डायरेक्टर, मिस एन अटेन, सीनियर कॉन्फ्रेंसिस, मिस्टर अरुण काले, फाउंडर अस्कार, मिस्टर अनिरुद्ध पटनायक, ड्रिलिंग मैनेजर, जिंदाल ड्रिलिंग एंड इंडस्ट्रीज लिमिटेड, डॉक्टर आर डायरेक्टर SPD, एंड आवर चीफ गेस्ट मिस्टर प्रमोद कुमार शर्मा, अलॉन्ग विद ऑनरेबल मेंबर्स फ्रॉम IITC साउथ सेंट्रल एशिया एंड IITC MIT पुणे चैप्टर एज वेल. आई वुड लाइक टू इन्वाइट मिस्टर अरुण कार्ले, प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ अस्कारा ग्रुप, हु हैज बीन इन ऑयल इंडस्ट्री फॉर ओवर 50 इयर्स, टू शेयर अ फ्यू वर्ड्स विद अस.
कार्ले जी नमस्कार.
नमस्कार कार्ले जी.
फ्रॉम ह्यूस्टन. फ्रॉम ह्यूस्टन, वेरी गुड सर. आपका तो नाइट हो गया होगा. थैंक यू. थैंक यू फॉर ज्वाइनिंग
सर. आई थिंक कार्ले सर इज नॉट देयर राइट नाउ. वी मे जॉइन लेटर.
ओके ओके ओके, नो प्रॉब्लम. Nishit, you can start. You can continue.
Okay, sir. Now I would like to introduce Dr. R.K. Vij, our director of SPT. Dr. Vij is an industry professional with over 40 years of experience in various facets of the E&P industry. Dr. Vij retired as the executive director of Jorhat Asset ONGC Limited, Assam. He also served as advisor to ONGC board. He was responsible for first geocellular modeling of Mumbai Highfield. He implemented first miscible EOR in Gandhar, Gujarat, and immiscible gas injection EOR in Borhola, Assam. He has been awarded for his accomplishments during his tenure in ONGC by the Honorable Vice President of India, CMD, and directors of ONGC.
Okay.
From the Union Minister of Railways. I am sorry for the network from my side. He has also received an award for significant contribution in international law as a part of Study in India campaign from the Union Minister of Railways and Commerce Industry in 2020. I kindly request Dr. Vij to share his thoughts with us.
Okay, good morning and welcome to our chief guest today, Pramod Kumar Sharma ji. And I am really thankful to Sharmaji for sparing his time for all of us in such a pandemic time. As you know, you all know that Dr. Mr. Sharma is having his degree from IIT BHU, and then for almost for 4 decades he has served the company All India Limited. During his tenure, basically he is in geophysics, but during his tenure he has contributed a lot towards the oil industry from Oil India and in Indian scenario. He was very much, his contribution is significant. As you all might be knowing that the production of oil and gas is a high-tech area, and Mr. Sharma was heading the director operations portfolio for continuously 5 years. During this 5 years, the production, the best thing is that how to maintain the production from matured field. Sustaining the production is a big thing. And Mr. Sharma's contribution in sustaining the production is very significant, as we are observing in our fields, like in ONGC and other field, that production is declining and sustaining it is a very difficult task. But thanks to and hats to Sharmaji and his team in Oil India that their production continued remain above 3 million tons from almost, I think, more than 20 years. I am observing the Oil India production. So it has touched even 3.5 figure and it is almost beyond 3 million tons. It's a remarkable achievement by the national oil companies, because we know that in national oil company, we work in a boundaries conditions, and even then to sustain the production is a big thing. So first of all, I am thankful to Sharma ji for sparing his time for all of us. And thanks to all the IADC members, Mike Dos and others. Mike Dos, we are really thankful to IADC. We are continuing with this IADC platform. this is, I think, third or fourth lecture in the series in last 2 months, and we are inviting all the big people with good experience, and our students are being benefited. I am also welcoming all other than PDPU, other students and professors from the faculty from the other places in India and abroad. And my congratulations to the team, our IADC team headed by Mr. Dr. Hari, Dr. Vivek Patel. Vivek has also contributed a lot for organizing this lecture. Mr. Gaurav Hajarika and the student team. Student team is really upbeat, and they are very motivated. I think whether it's a Virag, Parag, or the Nishit, and all of them, my congratulations to all of them. Continue doing these type of things, and it's a pandemic time. And I assure you that during this pandemic, oil industry is least affected because of your contribution, that your continuous knowledge dissemination by virtual media is continuing, and we are all benefited in a new norm which has been set in last 9-10 months. I am also thankful to each and everyone from IADC, and once again, thank to Mr. Sharmaji. And this is Sharmaji, this is a starting point. We look forward for your continuous cooperation and support from your side. After pandemic, we would like to invite you to our PDPU for one-to-one meeting, or for giving us the knowledge which you have gained during your four decades experience in a varied environment, whether it's a offshore or a international operation or seismic or operations in Oil India in a difficult logistic area. So we will be benefited by your knowledge, and I will look forward for your continuous cooperation. And physically also, I would like to, as soon as this COVID is over, so first thing is that we would invite you and in the our PDPU campus, and we will at different platforms we will share with you the PDPU university's detail. It's a university with a difference. It's a non-profit organizations type thing. It is a brainchild of our present Prime Minister and the then Chief Minister Narendra Modi ji. And this university have in last 13 years, it has developed itself into a very vibrant university. In fact, in recent convocation on 21st of November, Prime Minister Modi himself has appreciated our effort. In around 14 years, we have walked in a very big way, and we are also going to change the name of the university from Pandit Deen Dayal Petroleum University to Pandit Deen Dayal Energy University, which was coined by our Prime Minister, present Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji. So we are on the verge of changing this scenario, and in the energy perception, we will definitely would like to contribute not only in petroleum. We are working in solar, we are working in wind, we are working in CBM, shale gas, and gas hydrate. So these are our other area related and unrelated area of petroleum. So definitely we will be benefited with your experience. And once again, thanks to everybody for giving me the opportunity to share my thoughts. Thank you very much. Thank you, Nishit.
Thank you, sir, for imparting your wisdom with us. Without any further delay, I take this opportunity to introduce our chief guest, Mr. Pramod Kumar Sharma. He served as Director of Operations for Oil India Limited. He is a postgraduate in geophysics from Banaras Hindu University and also possesses a PG diploma in management with dual specialization in HR and international business from AIMA New Delhi. Sir has to his credit an experience of more than 35 years in the E&P industry in India and abroad. Before being OSD, he was Group General Manager of Business Development at Corporate Office in Noida. He led the business development team in Oil India Limited while discharging the additional responsibilities as the CEO of Oil India International Limited. Prior to that, he acted as General Manager, looking after the offshore operated projects and supporting the NELP E&P programs of the company. I would like to humbly invite Mr. Pramod Kumar Sharma to carry this webinar ahead.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Sharma. Thank you, sir.
It is my privilege and honor to be a part of the PDPU STEAM University. I'd like to thank Dr. Vij for inviting me.
Thank you.
And for being a part of this esteemed university. And all the members, faculty members, the organizers. Dr. Vij has requested me about 2 months back, but I'm sorry that I was busy with with my personal assignment, so I could not honor. So this time I told that yes, I'll be joining. So once again, thank you, Dr. Vij, for inviting me. And I'd also like to thank all the organizers and the members and the faculty members, all the students and all the people who are a part of this this presentation today. I have made a slight presentation, so which will be easy for me to describe the thing. So I think you are able to see.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Share. You can share. You can share.
Yeah. So this is the on the challenges for ENP industry.
Is it share nahi hua? Share nahi hua. Share nahi hua, sir. Abhi.
Main to likh diya isme share screen.
सर एक वो एरो सा बनाया ना जो माइक के साथ उसको वहां से शेयर होता है पराग यू जस्ट टेल सर अबाउट शेयरिंग
सर तीन डॉट के बाद लेफ्ट साइड जो एरो है उसमें आपको ओपन शेयर ट्रे दिखेगा
एरो
में के साथ हां एरो में क्लिक करना है
तीन डॉट में
एरो में लीव बटन के बगल में लीव लेफ्ट साइड ऑफ लीव बटन
शेयर हो गया
अच्छा ये हो गया
शेयर से दबाना पड़ेगा
यस यस
अभी अभी हुआ
यस सर
ओके
यस सर हो गया सर
ओके सर
वेरी गुड
सो दिस इज इफ यू सी आउट ऑफ माय सिक्स डिकेड्स ऑफ लाइफ Four decades have been associated with the ENP industry. So I thought that this challenges for the ENP industry, particularly with respect to the Indian context, and whatever I have little bit I have learned during these four decades, I like to share with the audience. So this coverage will be broadly into these five, six points that what are the challenges. What are the challenges which I perceive and what are the challenges which the industry is facing in the exploration front, on the production front, and one more thing which has come recently into this ENP industry is the concern for the environment, which was not there in earlier when we were studying. So much concern was not there for the environment. Now environment has become a very very important aspect in any operation, in anything which we do. And then what are the disruptive technologies which has made the which has changed the things. And recently this COVID has also come, so what is the effect of this on the ENP? And then finally the reforms and the incentives with the government of India has taken to incentivize the to increase the ENP activities in India. So first of all, the challenges in the exploration. This earlier we there is a famous saying that days of EG oil has gone. It is really true if you see the industry. Over both there are two main national oil companies, ONGC, the Big Brother, Oil India, and there are several private operators. And if you see the last four decades, there has not been many big discoveries, particularly in the last two, three decades. So the discoveries have been very, very small, not very big. Earlier, when we, if we talk about Bombay High, we have not heard those this type of big discoveries in our recent time. So the and the what has happened that out of the 3.2 million square kilometer of the area, now our exploration has gone from the easy areas to the hostile terrain. If you see the towards the northeast, particularly the northeast, if you see the thrust areas, if you see the hill areas, if you see the deep water areas. So now the exploration has shifted from the easy areas, which are self area. If you see the Assam self, if you see the Gujarat self area, if you see the Bombay self area, if you see the KG self area, now the exploration has shifted from these easy areas to the logistically difficult areas and hostile environment. If you see the, as I have talked, the belt of Supain, if you see the number of thrust which are there, the exploration has become a challenge, because now the studies which have shown that most of our resources, they lie in those areas and the deep water areas where the water depth more than 400 meters, 500 meters, 600 meters, 1000 meters. So this is the trend which has changed from our easy areas to the difficult area. And then I have already told that we have not found any big oil and gas field during our recent last 2-3 decades. This is the landscape, how it has changed. This thing has been also affected by the uncertain oil price. This is now the world has become a village. If anything happens outside, this affects the whole world. If you see the uncertain oil price, if you see the oil price has not been very constant. It is dingling sometimes very high, sometimes it is very low. And because of the low oil price, what has happened, the immediate effect is on the exploration hardened. The significant, your capex plan are cut immediately. Only the production, for maintaining the production, the things are maintained. But the exploration front, because it is a long-term investment. So those long-term investment in the capital expenditure is immediately reduced. So what is the immediate casualty is that the exploratory drilling is reduced, and also there is no big oil find, and unappraised areas are also more than 50%, particularly in India. This is the screen dump. If you see the oil price, which is known to everybody, but just to emphasize the point that how the oil price have been affected. If you see the from 1920 to 75, there has been something which has caused this changes in the oil price. If we see the embargo on Arab, then we see the Iran-Iraq war, then we see the Kuwait invading Iran invading Kuwait, then there has been a financial crisis. Arabs have control. Now there has been a pandemic which we see that recently now it has come to about $30-$43. So there have been something which has caused this problem to happen. And recently the America, which was importing oil, has become a exporter of the oil. So that has also caused a very big change in the oil. So it is balancing. So the point which I am trying to drive from here, if anything happened outside world, in anywhere in the world, the oil price gets affected immediately. So the what has happened, because of this low oil price, exploration has got affected. And the exploration is the key for more oil and gas. If you want to, as Dr. Veej was telling, that sustaining the production is a very, very difficult task. He has been in ONGC. He knows that how the production is declining. There is all of you may be knowing that worldwide, if you see the decline in the field, 7-8% is the average decline. Some fields decline 13%, 14%. If you see recently ONGC and Oil India, they have taken producing assets in Russia. There the offshore, the production is declining by 13-14%. So if you see the average, the decline is about 6-7%. So if we maintain the production, that is a very important point which the people just do not consider. Maintaining production means you are increasing your production by 6-7%. So that is the whole key in the oil and gas. So ONGC and Oil India are operating the fields which are more than 30, 40 years old. So there the decline is already there about 6 to 7%. So if we maintain the production, or if there is only decline of 1 or 2%, that means we are increasing the production by 6 to 7%. How this is happening? This is happening because of the different activities, finding more oil and gas. Although, as I told, that the big fields have not been there, but small fields are being discovered. So how these small fields are coming? That is the because of the new technologies, because of the integration of different disciplines. Earlier, what has used to happen, the people used to work in different domains. Say the imaging people will give the model to the geologist will give to the production engineer, then the reservoir engineer, they used to work in a separate domain. But now the integration has come. You cannot work in isolation. Now the recent thing which has come in the last 2-3 decades, because of these challenges, this has not come because of its own, but because of the challenges, since the new big oil fields are not there, and now the only thing, it is difficult to maintain, sustain the production. So the integration of different disciplines have taken place, whatever are related to the E&P industry. So those disciplines have been integrated. So that is how the production of the companies is being sustained. Particularly, if you see in India, ONGC and Oil India, I will talk about the two national oil companies, they are able to sustain their production. There is slight up and down, but broadly this production is being sustained. And this is because of the finding small oil field, small discoveries, and the number of discoveries are more, but those are very small. So as I have already discussed, that this exploration has shifted to the difficult areas, and then in the difficult areas you incur more cost, because if you see the drilling cost, if you see the imaging cost, and if you see the production cost, they are more in those difficult areas. And then this has also been affected by the, as I have already discussed, about the oil prices. And then just to give a small data, that how this drilling have been affected. In the USA, the drilling came down to 700 in March 2020, and which was as high as 1900 in end of the 2014. I'll also be talking about the Indian scenario, that how it has affected. If we see the exploratory and development drilling in India, if we see the number of exploratory well, which used to be in 2010 and 11, which was around 200, has come down to around 121. So this has there is a continuous decline into the exploratory drilling. The reason is, as I told, that the exploration is not shifting to the logistically difficult areas, where the drilling cost and the imaging costs are very high. So you cannot go and drill there without the sufficient data, and also the structures are very complicated, and the drilling also takes a lot of time. There are downhole complications. So that is how the whole thing is, which is reflected here, that from 200 level, we have come to about 121. So this is the because that we are shifting to the logistically difficult and challenging area. Because of that, our drilling activities in the exploratory drilling has also reduced, and also the effect of those oil prices has also affected. And now, if you see the development drilling, of course, is being maintained about level of from 400 to 500 level, because the development brings the production. The similar graph on the different thing, and also it is showing the meterage also, because now both the things, as I already told, that this exploratory drilling is coming down. Now, if you see the hydrocarbon resource potential of India in the sedimentary basin, if you see the whole area, about 3.3 million square kilometer, out of that 50% area is in the on land, and the 50% area is in the offshore. And in the offshore, the 12% is in the shallow water and about 40% in the deep water, more than 400 meters. So this is the aerial distribution of the sedimentary basin. And the resource assessment, which was done earlier, now it has been reassessed because a lot of data has come, both in terms of the seismic, both in terms of the drilling, production. So these data, which has come recently, this has been assessed, and the sedimentary basins have been reassessed. The hydrocarbon potential based upon this new data has been reassessed. So this what is the result of this reassessment? The reassessment, the 26 sedimentary basins, and if you see that the nearly half of the area has been explored. And out of 1.6 has been explored. So another 1.6 is remaining to be explored. So what is the reassessment result? That from a level of 28 billion tons of oil equivalent, we have jumped to a level of 42 billion tons of oil equivalent. So this is a big jump. Well, this about 50% increase in the unrisked hydrocarbon potential of the sedimentary basin. So this for the ENP people, that these are the resources which are there, which gives a direction that yes, you, this from 28 billion, we have 42 billion. So this 42 billion is lying in our basin. And then our challenge is to find that 42 billion tons of oil equivalent. So this has been a government of India under the leadership of ONGC and the supervision of DGH. This job has taken about three, four years. Both Oil India and ONGC, they were involved, and it was led by ONGC team. All the data, which was whatever was available, both the private operators, the data, private operator data was made available by DGH. DGH was also a part of this study. So a very significant work has been done from 28 billion ton of oil equivalent to 42 billion tons of oil equivalent of oil and gas. So this is the type of resources we are having. This is another way of looking at this, that the areas which has come from 18,000 to 35, category 1 basin has gone, category 2 basin has gone from 1,000 to 3,000, and category 3 basin has gone to 1,200 to 4. So major jump has been in the category 1 basin, because the category 1 basin have been explored, more exploration has been there, there has been more discoveries. So that is how this has increased. And from 28 billion tons of oil equivalent, we have reached to 42 billion tons of oil equivalent with the reassessment done in 2017. So what is the message from this geoscientific? We need to, we have already seen that from 28 billion tons of oil equivalent, we have assessed that there is a 42 billion tons of oil equivalent lying in the Indian basin. So we have to increase our effort to find that hydrocarbon. How? So we need to increase our exploratory effort. An exploratory effort for finding more hydrocarbons to reach to the level of that 42 billion tons of oil equivalent. But because of the unfortunate situations like low oil price, the exploratory efforts have reduced. So there is a already we know that wherever there is a challenge, then there is an opportunity. So like that for the ENP industry, there are challenges, so there are opportunities also. We will discuss that how those opportunities are coming. So now the challenges is that from the easy areas, we are moving to the difficult areas, so which we call in our language the frontier areas. remote areas where the we're reaching to those areas. If you reach the, if you see the normal area, we can reach in 1 hour. Then in for reaching the difficult area, it takes 5 hours to 6 hours to reach to that site. And even there may not be very difficult terrain to do the exploration. So not only the surface challenge, but there are also the subsurface challenges. The geology is very complex. There are thrust. There are lot of high pressure zones. And so whatever challenges we can imagine, those are there now in our exploration. So how to for these challenges, there are opportunities for us, for the new students which are coming into the industry. So now the new technologies are coming. Now a new understanding is, that is why I told that the integration. Suppose you know something, he knows something. So now this has to be integrated. So integration has become a very, very important aspect. And now the new students which are coming into the industry, they have a tremendous knowledge of this integration, how to integrate the surface imaging, how to integrate the production data, how to integrate the drilling data, how to integrate those anomalies into that our advantage. So now this is the opportunities which has come because of this challenges. Now the unconventional hydrocarbon have also come into the into place. They say like shale gas and oil, oil sand. Some of them are not very significant for India because of the limited resources. Oil and oil, shale and gas has got a big jump when the US, particularly US, when everywhere there was a shale oil and gas, then whole world started thinking towards the shale oil and gas. But Indian, if you see the India, this is very limited because since I have been in Oil India, so I'll talk about the Oil India. Our source rock, which is there, which creates this shale oil and gas, is not mature enough to create that shale oil and gas. These are lying into deep into the basin area, where thrust area, where it is difficult to find those. So that is one of the regions, and also the our shale which are there in the Rajasthan, they are not mature enough to create that shale gas and oil. ONGC of course have some areas, but also it is very 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 limited. And then the CBM has also, Government of India has given the many rounds, but the production has not gone to a very high level. There is a limited production of ONGC and some private operators. Oil India has not had one or two block, but we could not make the production there. Now recently, Dr. Vij has already told that the area of the gas hydrate has also come. India has a tremendous potential in the gas hydrate. Which two campaigns have been done. Earlier the gas hydrates which were found in the shale, now the second campaign was done where the drilling was done into the sand pocket. So I am very happy to learn that PDPU is also taking the gas hydrates into the forefront. Now the since you are the petroleum engineers, so the challenge will be how to produce those gas hydrates. So the aim should be that how to produce those gas hydrates. So that can be one of the challenges which the new students which are going to pursue that in that direction, that how to produce those gas hydrates, because there has not been very commercial technologies which are readily available. But nevertheless, like when the shale gas and oil has started in US, there was also not a very ready-made technology available. But because of the sustained effort and the industry, this has come. But there is a difference, because that was a very simple area in the into the gas shale and oil, whereas this gas hydrates is really a very challenging challenging area. But as I have already told, wherever there is a challenge, there is an opportunity. So gas hydrate is also one of the challenge and also an opportunity for the new generation. This so and now more than this subsurface challenge, there are surface challenges in those shale oil and gas. Now the environment is a concern. Well, for the hydraulic fracture, you require a lot of water and you have to dispose a lot of water. So this is a big challenge that on the apart from the subsurface, so the surface challenge, one of the secretaries in MOPNG was there in one of the workshop in shale oil and gas. There he was telling that in the shale oil and gas, the challenges are more on the surface than the subsurface, because subsurface challenge you can handle by the engineering methods. But the surface challenges which are involve the society, which involve the environment, which are very uncertain, is difficult to challenge. This oil sand mining is not very very significant, not very applicable to us. And the falling cost oil price, because as I have already told that the first victim is the exploration as soon as the oil price falls. So now from the point of E&P industry, that as we have told that these big fields are not there, we have to find the small of the smallest. We have to find those untrapped. From 28 billion ton of oil equivalent, we have reached to a level of 42. So more than 50% has increased. So where those hydrocarbons are lying? It has been established that they are lying in the difficult area. So your challenge is manifold. So it is lying in the difficult area. It is lying in pockets. So now we have to find with a more bigger microscopic level those untrapped hydrocarbon plays. So now what are the focus areas? There we have seen that the drilling has reduced from a level of 200 to exploratory drilling to a level of about 120. So because of those changes into the landscape, now from the normal area, we have shifting to the difficult area where the drilling costs are high, where imaging costs are high, where production costs are very high. So that is the reason that our this drilling wells have reduced. So now we have to also reduce the risk in those areas because there are four elements. One is the your structure, one is your reservoir, seal, and the your migration. So those we have to reduce those risk on those four elements. So if for reducing those risks, you have to bring more and more technology. You have more and more integration. So that is how this exploration has slowed down into those difficult areas. The tune, which was about 200 exploratory wells per year, has come to about 120 exploratory wells per year. Now we have to identify the subtle traps, because that big anticlines which we see in the, if we see the Gandhar field, if you see the Narkatia, if we see the Jurajan, those big structures, that structure of about 10 square kilometer, because if India, we cannot talk about 120 square kilometer structure. We can talk about only 10-15 square kilometer anticlines, faulted closure anticlines, which are now it is difficult to imagine. Now we have to identify those small traps, structural traps, the traps which has been which are controlled by stratigraphy. So there is a sand shale subtle traps, which are the sands are stopped by the shale. So those type of small traps which have been identified. So there the role of the all the different disciplines has taken a very very important role. So now, as I'll told, the new students which are coming, so they have a big opportunity in this challenging environment. So exploration, as I had told, that it has shifted to the geologically complex area. Reservoir management, as in the initial talk, Dr. Vij has told that maintaining the production means that you are increasing the production by 7 to 8%. So where the reservoir management, because you are the physician of the these fields, so you know that how the reservoir is to be maintained, what is the optimum production, how the intervention is excuse me, what type of intervention is required, what type of which type of IUR your technology is to be implemented, because suppose there is some technology which is implemented in other area, it is not it cannot be implemented same technology here. So now you, that is why I am told you are the physician for the this field. You know that which type of technologies will be effective, fit for purpose technology. So reassessment of hydrocarbon uncertainty, as I told that these are the four factors which have to be reduced: structure, reservoir, seal, and the chart. What type of that structure, as I have already told that the geologically complex area, the imaging is very difficult. You cannot the energy does not penetrate into the subsurface. You don't get the proper subsurface image. If you do not get the proper surface image, then how you will plan your drilling? So this is one of the challenges. The reservoirs, you don't know where are the reservoirs are there in that structure or not, whether the structure is properly sealed or not, this seal there. Then after that seal, where there has been properly charged or not, so after the this for, so these are the four factors. These four factors are applicable for the normal areas also, but in the normal areas, addressing those structure, reservoir, seal, and the chart was the challenge was very, very less because of the not so complex subsurface. But now in the difficult areas, particularly in thrust belt area, the hilly terrain, and the deep water, this has become a big challenge. So here the role of the new petroleum engineers, it is very, very significant. What are the now the focus area from the imaging, subsurface imaging point of view? The traditional 2D, 3D has shifted to the multi-component seismic imaging has become very important. Reservoir geophysics has taken a very important role. How to find out from the seismic and the log data, how to integrate to find out those reservoirs. So this is how you will address from these two the structure. Then you will address these two from the reservoir point of view. Then also the seismic attributes, that how the lot of advances have taken place on the seismic attribute, which can indirectly you can find the reservoir faces. The different type of technologies have come that you can see the gas chimneys, 4D seismic modeling, the reservoir, particular reservoir management. Then how the production has changed the subsurface image during that this time lapse 3D. Say you have done the 3D, say 4 years back. After the 4 years production, how the oil front, how the gas, how the water has moved. So this will give you a indirectly the where the bypassed oil is there, where the your oil has trapped, which has not, because subsurface anisotropy is so much that you cannot, it is not homogeneous that oil will flow in a direction and you will be know that no, okay, here. So this has become a very important tool for the reservoir engineers, that how the your subsurface has changed, have taken place. Micro seismic has also become very important in finding those hydrocarbons, and the earth velocity model, that how the with the earth velocity model, how you can change. So all these things are there for your subsurface imaging, because these are just like you do your X-ray, then you do your ultrasound, then you do your CAT scan, then you do your MRI. So similar thing is happening, and our petroleum engineers are the doctors to see those images. So to see that CAT scan, to see that MRI, so you have those data with you, and then you can plan that you can the and your field is your patient. So and the data is with you, and that is why that is how I told that you are the physician to of the earth to decide about the technologies. Research and development, as I told that now the collaboration with the Educational Institute Joint Research have program have taken place. So know that what are the challenges of our industry, so you can address those challenges. And the knowledge transfer is very important, as Dr. Vij has told that we are now collaborating with different experts. So that is how that knowledge which has been gathered should be transferred from the one generation to another generation, which is happening in the oil industry also. When the new engineers they join, they get the knowledge from their seniors and how this has to be, because then only you can bring the development, then only you can add the value addition. And now this geoscience, which is a subject at the school level, should be so they attract the challenges. So attract the sector, organizing the seminars as which has been already done. I mean, PDPU is already. I am very happy to learn that you are having a regular seminar, your regular interaction. So you really are going into the right direction. That whatever is required to address these present challenges of the industry. Now I will come to the actual areas where lot of students must be. Now, since you are into this business, so it will be particularly a very big opportunity for the new students which are there. Now, it is a worldwide fact that our 70% of production comes from the matured field. Matured field means that, as you know, that there is a build-up, then plateau, then decline. Matured fields which are in the declining stage, which are already declining, as I told that about 7 to 8%. So our this 70% or not only India, 70% of the world production is coming from those fields which are declining at the rate of average rate of 7 to 8%. So now if this is the scenario that 70% is your from the matured oil field, there the this our production engineer role becomes very, very important. So there you have the 70% is your domain to work for. Out of this this thing, 80% comes from the big countries, US, Middle East and Russia. So now this 80% is from this, and 30% of the mature oil fields are making half of the worldwide production. So the point which is coming, that production is from the matured field now. And in the matured field, this role of the petroleum engineers is the key. How to manage those fields, how to manage those reservoirs, how to bring to the new technology, how to find the more production from these matured fields. I'll further come to those areas that way, how much is the production. This is the what I told that it is build up and declining. What is the matured field? I have already discussed production, but declining. Recovery factor is varying from 10 to 40%. In India, the recovery factor is around is about 22%. Worldwide, this recovery factor is varying from 10% to 40%. And so there is a lot of opportunity both in India as well as other areas. As I told, the 70% production is coming. The average, if you see, the recovery factor is about 35%. That means lot of oil is left behind. Where our challenge is there and opportunity. So we have lot of opportunity to increase this recovery factor. How the recovery factor will be increased, as we have told that to by more and more understanding of the subsurface, both from the imaging point of view, from the your geocellular model, from your production data, from your development drilling, from your new studies, make it from your reservoir management. So all those things have are very, very important for matured fields. So that is how you can increase from 35 to 40%, 50%. So there is a lot of opportunity for our young petroleum engineers, that our 70% is production is from those matured fields. Out of those, in those 70%, only 35% is the recovery factor. So we have still a lot of oil to produce. And so that is how this our opportunities for the young petroleum engineers is huge. So era, I already told that we are not getting any big discoveries. So we have to be dependent upon this. And what is the potential of this recovery factor that I'll just discuss? Particularly, let us see the Oil India, and this is the scenario as we are telling that 70% is the production coming from matured field. So this is the, I was talking about the self area. This is a normal area. There's a plain area, self area, where the exploration was being done from Oil India from last 50 years. And there, Dr. Vij has told in the introductory lecture that Oil India was able to maintain its production from these matured field to a level of more than 3 million ton of oil and about 3 BCM of gas in the recent time. This exploration has shifted from this this normal area to the difficult area. If you see, there are Himalaya, there are Naga thrust here. So both, and this is the Oil India area, and this is the ONGC area. So both Oil India and ONGC, from their matured area, this is River Brahmaputra. So both from this plain area, now they have shifted to the difficult area. We are going to Nagaland, Manipur, the Naga Thrust, Arunachal Pradesh, and Pasighat. So these are all difficult areas. There, the as we have seen, that that is why the reaching to those areas from drilling point of view, from imaging point of view, is more. That is why the from 200 level of exploratory drilling every year, we have come down to 120 exploratory wells here. Here, the all the reservoir management, here the production management. So 70% of production, which was I was telling about the worldwide, is coming from those matured field of both Oil India and the ONGC. And so our challenge for the our opportunities are huge for those petroleum engineers, because the recovery factor is only 20 to 22% both for Oil India and ONGC. I'm talking about this northeast, but in other areas also, if you see, the average is 22%. So the for our petroleum engineers, the opportunity is huge from in India as well as abroad. So you have to be so the 70% of your patients are the matured oil fields, which are there waiting for you to give them the proper treatment, so that they can increase their production from a level of 35% to a level of 50%. Now, if you see the discovery cycle in any basin, if you see the if you plot this discovery cycle in any basin, this is a normal log distribution. This is a copy book style. This is a real data which we have picked up from Oil India. In 1952, Nahar Katia field was discovered. A huge anticline structure. And this was discovered on a gravity high and a one-fold seismic data. So very easy to find those fields at that time in 1950. And this Nahar Katia was the first discovery of independent India. And then the Jorajan was discovered. Then the Moran was discovered. So all big oil fields are discovered in the initial stage, if you see the anywhere in the world. And I have not plotted the data of other field, but if we see in India also, if you see in the Gujarat, if you see the Bombay High, if you plot like this, then this will be the normal scenario. first of all, we get the large field in any basin. So this is, I'm talking Assam, Assam Northeast Basin. So there initially in the 1952, 53, 56, in the initial era of 50 to 70, we discovered those large fields. Then since the large fields are over, now the similar new technologies have come, then we are able to discover the medium field. Further, the new technologies are coming, then we are able to discover the small field, which I was talking about, that these are the small fields which are sustaining the production. These bigger oil fields are no more discovered in recent time. And these small fields, which are more in numbers, say earlier, suppose we discover Nahar Kadia one or two fields in a year. Now we are discovering small fields about 1 square kilometer, about 1.5 square kilometer. There are the numbers are more, but the in-place hydrocarbon is less. So this is a log normal distribution. We discover more large fields in the initial year, then the medium, then smaller oil field. And that is how the technologies has also, this is because of the technologies which have come. So if you go further down the line, after say 10 years, more better technologies may come. So which can give the better surface. So from smaller, we may have the micro small fields. So you never know that what is going to happen in by 2040. So by 2040, we can get still very small small fields. So this is how the log normal distribution of large, medium to small oil field. And the quantity also, we can see that 150 million ton, so we have come to a level of 1 or 2 million ton of oil. So this is the typical field implementation. If we initial see the primary discovery, if we see the about 20%, then if we see the secondary 35%, then improve. So here is the your opportunities are there. In India, we are having only about 22%. We can go to 35%. So whatever recovery has been done during our lifetime or during the lifetime of oil fields of ONGC and Oil India, more than that is still lying. So 20% we have, 22% we have discovered, and 55% is still lying. So there you have the lot of potential, more than the whatever has been done in last 50 years, more than that is there in the next 30, 40 years. So you have a tremendous opportunity from this level of 22% to a level of 55%. That is why I was telling that the new petroleum engineers have a big ocean for them to explore and to find out that their future. So you have a very bright future, that from 22% level to a level of reaching 55%, both in India as well as abroad. This is a small statistic that we consume about 93-94 million barrels of oil per day globally. So if we increase the recovery factor by 1%, so just imagine that we have to 35% is the average, and we can reach up to a level of 55%. If we increase the recovery factor only by 1%, then we can result in the additional reserves of 88 billion tons of oil equivalent, which can replace for 3 years of the current production. So you can imagine the production. If you 35 to 55, 20% increase in recovery factor will bring the hydrocarbon for next 60 years. So this is the challenge and the opportunity. So opportunities are huge. You just cannot imagine that the is lying on your table. The government of India has also brought out several schemes, several incentives for this IOR. I'll be touching upon those. So these opportunities are globally. It is not only in India, but also globally, everywhere the emphasis is on the how to operate the mature field, because our 70% production is coming from those mature fields. So challenges in the, what are the, these are some of the points which I have tried to capture. Depleted reservoir energy, earlier the oil and gas used to flow from its natural pressure, but now the reservoirs have depleted, very less energy to bring those oil and gas to the surface. Unwanted production, the water production has increased, the sand has increased. So those are the challenges of the matured field. Increased fluorescence issue, that well integrity, wells are very old. So now because of those gas and sands, the wells have started cutting water, sand, and the water loading in the gas well. So this has also increased your well operating cost. The effective drilling, as I have told, that how to completion of the wells. So in the challenges. And now the economics have come into the play, that suppose you have to produce that oil, what are the investment you are going to do? And the identification of right IOR-EOR schemes, which is suitable for a particular field, that is very important. So all these challenges, then for all those challenges, you are the physician to address those challenges based upon your different data. So that is how your integration is very important. It has to come to your table, and you have to assess those things, and then effectively you have to design the technology. Action plan for improved infill well, these are the standard technologies which are there and now which you come, and then certain re-entering to the certain well, implementation of the this serpentine, and particularly India, we have not done anything on the carbonated carbon dioxide injection. First of all, because you will require a lot of carbon dioxide, that is why a project is being implemented in Oil India where carbonated water will be injected. And one of the Harriet universities, lot of big players, they are contributing to that project, Chevron and Total, and a lot of big players. Oil India is also a part of that Harriet University project. There the study is being done that with the carbonated water, what is the recovery? And with the carbon dioxide, what is the recovery? If there is not much difference, then can we inject carbonated water instead of carbon dioxide? Because the carbon dioxide is a very, very important, very, very difficult task at the moment. So this project is being implemented, carbonated water injection. Initially, the normal water will be injected. And then at a later stage, one of the reservoirs have been identified where carbonated water will be injected. ONGC is also giving emphasis on this. I am not aware of their detail. Re-entering into the old wells, the site tracking and the finding of the hydrocarbons in the new zones, identifying left out reservoirs, fit for purpose technology. So there the surface imaging will be and the 4D seismic will also play an important role. These are some of the technologies which were implemented by Oil India, and all of you may be aware of those technologies. This electric submission pump, then hydro fracturing, gravel packing, radial drilling, chemical water shutoff, hesitation, steam gun, downhole. So these are some of the things which were implemented to sustain the production. So as and when the new technologies which are coming, Oil India and ONGC both are trying to implement those. Concern for the environment, as I have already told, that this has become very important, and I am very happy to learn from the initial introduction of Dr. Viz that this our PDPU is changing from the petroleum to energy. This is a very, very good thought, and really because our future is going towards those renewable, has also become a very important role. And now in the recently Prime Minister inaugurated in Gujarat the world's biggest solar and hybrid plant, solar and wind plant. So that is how our shift is also there. It will also, this is not going to replace our conventional hydro. It is going to supplement the our requirement, because the requirement of petroleum product is huge, from a level of about 220 million tons of oil. It is projected that our increase about 3 to 5%. Then we after say 2040 we will be requiring about 400-500 million tons of oil. So this will also just have a share into whatever is our requirement. So this is our installed capacity. We see the power which is being generated. 55% power is coming from the coal. Then your 23% is coming from gas. This solar, the electricity power. So the emphasis is to reduce this coal and diesel to move towards the safer hydrocarbon. Now let us come to the disruptive technology. What are we hear a lot of things that the EVs are coming. It is a fact that in some of the countries, there the electric vehicles have taken a very, very important role. And then, and this is a fact that it is a disruptive technology. How this will have an impact on E&P industry is to be seen. There are advantages, as you know, that this is a more 5 times more efficient. If you see the internal combustion engine, these are all normal things which are there. If you see the this efficiency, 17 to 21% is used here. About 90 to 95%. If you see the moving part, more than 2,000 here only 18 in the electric bike. So less and less friction. That is why the efficiency is more 20% to 90%, because the friction and other things are very, very less here. This these are some of the statistics which are being there. That we consumed about 30 million tons of petrol and 83 million tons of diesel in 1920. And then this PSE report that 70% consumption is in our vehicles. Petrol is in the two-wheelers. Now, the important point is that recently in one of the conferences, Prime Minister has given a target to India to increase the refining capacity from a level of 250 to a level of 500 tons per year by 2040. So this is the opportunity that we have to increase our efforts towards those. This is the type of consumption which are there from almost double. So from a level of 250 million ton, we are going to consume in next 20 years 500 million ton. So there is no effect of that disruptive technology, particularly to the Indian context. Yes, the electric vehicles will come because requirement is huge. It is not going to met by those electric vehicles in India. So here we are going in next 20 years, we are going to double our consumption. So those consumption, as we have seen, that this is coming from those areas which are there. So some of the challenges in the disruptive technologies, that cost of batteries, where we see that the batteries which are required, the material which is required in the batteries is not very easily available. I think that China has got the raw material which is required for the batteries. And then the initial investment cost is high. Then another thing is how to charge those electric vehicles. So this is the some of the challenges which are associated with that electric vehicles. So these are some of the statistics which were in the past, which were shown and which have proved that in that McKinsey, which carried out a study in mid-80s, they told that the this by 2000, the mobile subscriber will be about 1 million. And to our surprise, it has become to 109 million. So this, nobody can predict that what is going to happen in future. These are the some of the example. Solar, which was about 16 rupees per kilowatt per hour, has fallen down to a level below 3 rupees in 2017. Similarly, the cost of LEDs, which was at 310 rupees, has gone to 38 rupees in August. So these are the effect of those disruptive technologies. So really, what do we need to be? Do we really need to be worried? No, I say big no, because I have already told that this that our 70% production is coming from the matured field, where we have to, and the recovery factor is only 35% globally, 22% in India, and we are going to consume from 250 million ton to 500 million ton in 2040. So during this 40 years, so whatever recovery factor has been done in last 50 years, we can do it in the next 40-50 years. Those products. So from 22%, we have to increase to 55%. That recovery factor. So the opportunities are huge. So this is the shift which is taking place. Coal, which was there in the 90s, has come to a broadly come down globally, and other renewables are energies. So this is the scenario that different type of energy sources are being used. Natural gas has become very, very big now, and in India is also going to increase the contribution of gas from a level of 6% to a level of more than 10%. And we have seen that in Gujarat, if you see the world average of gas consumption is about 20 to 23%, and Gujarat itself has more than the world average. So there are several factors that how that gas contribution in Gujarat has taken place. So, but in India, the target has been kept that we will be increasing from our increase from 6% in 2018 to a level of 10 to 15% in 2050 in the gas scenarios. Energy consumption, this is a BP energy outlook that growing at a level of 2.5 to 3% per annum. So, this is much faster than the economies. So our opportunities are there. That in India, we are going to consume from 250 million ton to a 500 million ton by 2040. That is why the refining capacity, the Prime Minister has told that to increase the refining capacity from a present level of 250 to 500 million ton. So there is no there is no worry that this petroleum industry is going to get affected by the disruptive technology, no, or by the renewable, no, because the scale of increase into that conventional hydrocarbon is much more than the increase in the renewable or the disruptive technology. So our young petroleum engineers, they have a lot of opportunity for increasing this production from a level of 22% to a level of 55% in India, and globally from 35% to a level of 55%. And 70% of your fields are matured fields, which are lying for your intervention. Share of coal is going to get decreased because of that environmental concern. Renewable energy, yes, is going to is becoming an important aspect, and our which is there in India is the leader in that renewable energy, particularly solar. Gas consumption is going to get increased from 6% to a level of more than 10%. These are the some of the energy predictions which have been done in the business as usual scenario and the share what will happen into that oil and gas, say oil is 22%, gas is 50%, business as usual. But if you see the net zero, that means if we are able to maintain that commitment which has been given, that then it, the scenario will be like this. Whatever are the thought that whatever has been thought that to reduce that carbon footprint and to reduce that temperature by less than 1.5 degrees Celsius, then this will be the, if you meet those targets 100%, these are the numbers which will be coming, 50% from renewable. But if we are in between those things, then it will be about 70% contribution from those. So this is the net net zero and rapid, which implies that yes, oil will be gradually reducing during the time, but the quantum is so high that even if the share reduces, then the quantum of oil, condensed hydrocarbon, is going to get increased. Increase in the gas share, still oil and gas will remain the dominant fuel in India. So this is the key here, that our still that hydrocarbon industry will have a very, very important role in the economy of India. And renewable energy will be growing at a very fast rate. Final words, there are abundance of untrapped hydrocarbon, and we should not be complacent. That means we have already seen that reassessment has shown from 28 billion ton of oil equivalent to 42 billion ton of oil equivalent. So there is a 50% increase in the hydrocarbon, unrisked hydrocarbon potential, from 28 billion ton to a 42 billion ton. So that is one of the big opportunity, that yes, we have from 28 billion ton to 42 billion ton of oil equivalent. The second thing is that the we have 70% production coming from our matured field. So, and the recovery factor globally is only 35%. We have to increase the production to a 55% level. So the another second opportunity for the industry. And then in India, the recovery factor is only 22%. So increasing by 35%. Yes, environment has become a concern, which has to be, which are being challenged by our different technologies. Change is inevitable, because we have never thought that solar will be so much important. Now it has, the change is continuous because of the situation. And environmentally friendly manners we have to work out. The COVID effect, which have, I need not to elaborate on those things. Many countries that lockdown has taken place, and then the 60% the crude oil demand has dropped a lot. That is how the price of oil has come to a level of less than $30 per barrel. Now it has stabilized to 40-45. So now the COVID effect has came, but mainly because of the demand in oil. So crude oil price have this, as I told, that demand dropped from 100 million barrels per day to 73 million per day. That is why, because of the oversupply of oil, and price has gone to abnormally low. This is the price scenario which we have seen, that average price which has which was there, it has come down from January, it was about 64. It came down to in April, and during that lockdown started worldwide. So from lockdown, it has come to now, it has come to a 43 level. Whereas in the previous year, when there was no effect of lockdown, the supply was sustained to a level of 93, 94 million barrels of oil per day. It was about more than $60 per barrel. So look our regime opportunities for India. We can increase our strategic reserves we can renegotiate the LNG price because of the low oil price. These are the opportunities. Now the government has also taken a lot of reforms in the policies, both in the exploration as well in the production front. So on the exploration front, they have brought out a lot of new policies, which is a national seismic program whole. As I told that more than 50% area is lying, which has not been properly explored. So there the national seismic program, which was done by ONGC and in Northeast by Oil India and other part of India by ONGC. So national seismic program will bring the subsurface image of the basin, which will implement in, which will be available to the whole world for deciding about the area. Price freedom has been given in the difficult area, STSP. Policy reform, early monetization of CBM, then discovered and oil fields have come. So these are the reforms and the incentives which is given by the government of India, both on the exploration and the production. So this is the hydrocarbon exploration help policy which has come. Open earlier used to be the cost was to be reimbursed. Now this is the revenue sharing. So you can select the area by yourself. You can give the government decide that on this revenue we will be sharing. Now recently the another policy has come, which is you need not to share the revenue what was earlier also. So now three rounds of OLF have come. So this has increased this exploration activity. Now a lot of incentives have come for the IOR, EOR also. So this was all about my presentation. I think I have taken your more than 1 hour, which was allotted to me. So
thank you, sir, for such a captivating presentation. I am sure that the students are now aware about the industry challenges and more importantly, work in the direction of seizing the opportunities that would arise along with these challenges. Now I would like to open the floor for questions.
Yeah.
We have the first question from Dikshit Sabani, who is from PDPU. He asks, how has the growth of renewable energy usage posed as a challenge to the E&P sector?
Okay. As I have already told that this renewable is not a challenge to the E&P industry, because the amount of energy which is required from the conventional hydrocarbon is huge, as we have seen that from the projections which are coming from 250 million ton of oil, our requirement is going to be 500 million ton, because as the development is taking place, more and more people will require vehicles, more and more people will require the easy access to the light. Our villages will shift towards the more better houses, there the energy will be required. So this E&P industry is not having immediately a challenge from the renewable, because renewable will just will be having a small contribution in the overall requirement of the energy. So hydrocarbon is not having a big challenge from the renewable, particularly concerned as far as concerned to the Indian scenario.
We have the next question from Jayesh Belani, who is from PDPU as well. Sir, if we promote gas-based economy, will it not suppress the research work and growth in unconventional hydrocarbon sectors?
No, it will not have that, because the gas, the gas will be used at a cost of coal. Because wherever we are having a coal, wherever we are having a bad type of fuel. So those gas is replacing those conventional fuels. So it will not have an effect on the whatever is research or whatever whatever things are studies are being to the other, because it is replacing the contribution, it is reducing the contribution of coal, and to some extent it is the diesel and other thing, because that growth which I am take, which I'm again repeating the same thing, that from 250 we are requiring 500. This is the amount of conventional hydrocarbon which we require, and then also the contribution from the other areas will also come. So our requirement is huge, because we are consuming about 800-900 million ton of oil equivalent. So our requirement will be huge during 50. So the conventional hydrocarbon will have its own, will have the normal growth, and supplement will come from this, small supplement will come from the renewable. So gas is not going to replace, and it is just from 6% to, we are going to more than 10% at the, and the contribution share, the only share will be reduced. The quantity may remain same or increase, but the share of percentage will vary.
Thank you, sir. Raj Kotia from PDPU as well asks, what are the new areas of research in reservoir when it comes to tight reservoir?
Particularly in the tight reservoir, when we see that the challenges which are there, that how to drill those areas, what type of subsurface mud is required, how to find those tight reservoir, both from the challenges and research is both from the imaging, number one. Number two, the finding the tight reservoir properly, and how to drill that, and then how to produce from that tight reservoir. What type of fluid you will require? What type of the perforation you will be required? What type of activation? How to stimulate those tight reservoirs so that this can be brought to the level? So, right from the imaging, right, then the drilling, then the perforation, then stimulating those reservoirs. So there is a whole integration of things which are required from the from those tight reservoir. Say we have seen that radial drilling, one of the tight reservoirs which we have seen in our area. So there the jet drilling was done. So it was a number of jet type of water. The drilling was done, rare drilling was done. So there are further technology. Now you will have to stimulate it, the reservoir, with some chemical. You may have to put some heating things into those reservoirs. So there's a whole gamut of things which are required for those tight reservoirs to produce.
Thank you, sir. Parag Bhurania from PDPU as well asks, what are the new challenges that we witness when E&P industry is moving from digital, from traditional methods?
Now, the E&P industry has already moved from already moved to digital from the conventional method. Now, because you cannot remain isolated. Now that now everywhere there is a digital thing which has come. If you see from imaging, earlier we used to interpret this seismic data on the paper. Now it has come to workstation. Now from workstation you can see the visualization center. Now you can see the online drilling, how it is going to happen. You can monitor all the drilling parameters at one place, suppose remotely. Drilling is taking place somewhere, you can see all the drilling. So this has helped the petroleum engineers to bring the lot of data at one place so that you can take a better decision. Now this has brought the efficiency. This has reduced the risk. This has reduced the better accuracy. So digital has brought lot of, made your life very easy so that you can take better decision. You can take accurate decisions. You can integrate lot of data. Because integration is the order of the day. Without integration, you cannot proceed. You cannot reduce the risk. You cannot you cannot bring the proper IOR technology. So that is why and this has been possible because of the digitization. Now we have seen that IOR, EOR, then. Another term has come recently, the DOR. digital oil recovery. How, what is the digital oil? All the data, which is thousands and billion and trillion of data, which is lying there on the missing online in the ENP industry, will be brought that data to the table, that how to bring that data to a level which can be understood by each and everyone is a new challenge in the for the industry. That how to bring that data, how to train that data, how to segregate those outliners from that data. So this is another very big opportunity, that digital oil recovery. So that the data which is there, the production data, the drilling data, which has during the drilling, what are the challenges which have taken place during the production, which has taken place, and those bringing those time domain data and spatial data into one platform is also an opportunity. So digital has become a very, very important tool for our young new petroleum engineers for enhancing this oil recovery.
Thank you so much, sir, for a great Q&A session and clarifying our doubts. Now I would like to invite Dr. Veej again for concluding remarks.
Thank you very much, sir. Really, I think during COVID in 9 months, I have attended more than 50 webinars, and I can tell that this today's webinar was the best among them. So congratulations to Sharmaji, and clapping for Sharmaji. I think we should clap for Sharmaji. It's a real one or two more things I will say, sir, that Sharmaji has shown a real ENP man, right from geophysics to the IOR and EOR. So that is what is required in the oil industry, that a person join in a one particular arena and then ultimately becomes a complete ENP man. So that is what the lecture of Mr. Sharma has shown. There are 3-4 points which I have noted down, and I think we have to take action. Number one, Sharmaji's views and concern about exploration going down. We know, as a petroleum engineer, and that is my personal observation, that we have done that geologist and geophysicist, we have sent back to the, not on the driver's seat. And that is the result that exploration is suffering. And second thing is that what Sharmaji have told about, this is information for me. I was knowing that division of prognosticated resources is going on. But 42 million is a big jump, and it's a good news for all of us. All people working in ENP industry, it's a good news that from 28, it has jumped to 42 billion ton. It means it's a large scope exists for exploration and production. So this is very two important things. And Sharmaji has covered almost everything, right from the energy, from the reservoir management, from IOR, etc. One or two things for IADC. What Sharmaji has pointed out, note down, that geoscientist, that we should go to schools, 11th class, 12th class. We should utilize IADC platform. And then in school, we should tell them geoscience. It's a definitely they are lacking the knowledge. And that's why when they are in a dilemma where to go, they are thinking of computer engineering, ICT, chemical engineering. If they know the importance of geoscience at 11th class or 12th class, definitely then they can decide whether to go join in a petroleum industry or not. One or two more thing, that renewable and all these. So what is there in your mind, in the mind of young minds, that I think that doubt should be now clear, that Sharmaji have told that whatever comes, whether the renewable comes, whether the EV cars comes, oil and gas will continue to have an important role in the total energy system. So you should not worry about this thing. Those who have joined this are benefited, and those who have not joined, definitely I'm sorry for that they have not joined, and they are lacking all this knowledge which Sharmaji has given out of his 40-year experience. My kudos to Sharmaji, and thank you very much, Sharmaji, for a very nice and very detailed presentation. I will say I have never expected this type of presentation, and it's really a webinar which I think most of the all the engineering college students should have this presentation. And I think we will ask Sharmaji if we can send this to all our students and even to faculty also. Some of new things which Sharmaji have told about EOR and IOR and recovery factors, that also needs to be. And even a petroleum engineer, one last thing, very good point that you are a doctor, physicians. And if you don't think, and a physician should know if a patient go to that particular physician. So whether he is suffering from cancer or TB or any other disease, so physician have some formula for that. Similarly, a petroleum engineer are the physicians of the well. And if they go to well, and if they talk to well, then only they can give the solutions. So my request to all young petroleum engineers that they should try to learn this these all technology, whether it's a seismic or whether it's a geology or whether it's a reservoir engineering. These things should be known to them. Then only, as you know, that physicians have almost all the knowledge. If you go to a physician ki bukhar hai ya aankh mein dard ho rahi hai, so he will provide some solutions. So you should know the solutions. And again, thank you to Sharma ji for sustaining the production of Oil India. So his significant contribution in last 5 years. So we appreciate in petroleum industry, when we are talking, we appreciate the Oil India effort. And in fact, some of the meeting, internal meeting of ONGC, we try to learn that what is good in Oil India, that whether they are, how they are maintaining the production, we are not able to. So this is a fact I am admitting to Sharma ji, that when we are talking in our within ONGC, so we are talking that how Oil India is maintaining the production, why ONGC is not able to maintain the production. So there are few things needs to be learned from Oil India professional approach and their strategic approach. And thank you very much, Sir Sharma ji. And definitely now I am 100% sure that as soon as this COVID will be over, so you have to come here to give the knowledge to our young faculty as well as students. Thank you, and thank you all IADC. Thank you very much. Thank you, Nishin.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you for once again. I like to thank Dr. Veech and their team for inviting me. Thank you very much, sir. And very nicely concluded by Dr. Veech. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Okay, Nishin. Anything else, Parag?
Yes, sir. There was just one request that let us request all the attendees to switch on their cameras if possible, so that we can take a photograph / screenshot of today's virtual gathering.
Sharma ji ka
aa nahi raha hai kya
Sharma ji aa gaya aa gaya theek okay
chalo abhi main tha nahi to maine
okay sir
main soch raha tha main aa gaya hu बहुत ही अच्छा आपने अगेन
बहुत ही अच्छा रहा और आपने बहुत ही अच्छे तरीके से छोड़ दिया मैं पूरे टाइम बैठा बहुत अच्छा लगा सर जो आपने एक्सपीरियंस शेयर किया ना दैट सिस्मिक टू फाइनली दैट ईओआर एंड ऑल दैट सो दैट इज इन फैक्ट रिक्वायर्ड हमारे यहाँ क्या हो रहा है बच्चे लोग अपने को कोई ड्रिलिंग में एक्सपर्ट बनना चाहता है कोई रिजर्वर में एक्सपर्ट बनना चाहता है बट दे शुड नो दैट एक्सपर्ट बन के जब ऊपर जाओगे कैरियर में 30 साल बाद तो बाकी जियोलॉजी भी पता होनी चाहिए जियोफिजिक्स भी पता होना चाहिए अगर नहीं पता होगा उस टाइम पे तुम नहीं डिलीवर नहीं कर
पाओगे
ओके सर थैंक यू सर
ओके सर थैंक यू
थैंक यू
सर थैंक यू सर
थैंक यू विवेक Vivek, thank you very much for coordinating all this thing. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes,
thank
sir. You, sir. We have vote of thanks left.
हाँ बोलो बोलो भी vote of thanks Virag तुम बोलो बोलो बोलो.
Yes, Smith is going to.
Now, Mr. D, the Vice Chairman of IDC PDPU, to give a vote of thanks.
Okay.
Good morning, everyone. We are honored by the presence of Pramod sir for sparing his invaluable time with us. Unfortunately, we are not having Mr. Arun Karle, his team, and Mr. Mike Dubose in this webinar, but we are thankful to them for the active involvement since the commencement of our student chapter. I would like to thank Dr. Arkevich for the help from time to time and providing us the constant support. I would like to thank Dr. Vivek Ramalingam for their coordination and guidance in organizing this event. I would like to thank Dr. Harish Srinivasan and Mr. Gaurav Hazarika for bringing the backbone of the IIDC PDQ student chapter. I would like to thank the host, Nishit Patel, for sailing us through the session. I would also like to thank all the students for their active participation and support throughout the session. That brings us to the conclusion of the webinar. Thank you all for joining the session. Stay home, stay safe, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay.